Hey, hello.
Video 3.
Yeah, nuclear chemistry and its uses. So what is nuclear chemistry? What's radioactivity? What is it good for?
I don't know. It's really just the study of the nucleus now, mm-hmm. of the atom, and what changes it goes through. We still, at this point, can only affect a nucleus so much.
Right.
We still can't do what we've always wanted to do from the Middle Ages.
Right.
Turn lead into gold.
Yeah.
We can't do that kind of stuff. But
right.
we have learned how to break and just like smash the thing.
Right.
And that's about as good as we can do in whatever it comes out as, it comes out as.
And in some cases, we've been able to smash but not break and slowly cause the number of protons to increase, which is why we've created, literally artificially,
some elements.
All of the elements that are heavier than uranium.
Yeah, the UUUs and the UUBs.
No, not even them. Not neptunium, plutonium, americium. Those are all artificial elements
Everyone
that humans
else?
Create. Yeah, plutonium doesn't exist naturally. It's too radioactive. It would fall apart.
Okay.
Uranium does, and you can turn uranium into plutonium.
We're not going to argue about this on video.
We're not going to.
But this will be on the special live YouTube feed after.
Yeah. The nucleus and its changes. That's what nuclear chemistry is.
Decay modes. You need to know the different kinds of decay.
Types of ionizing radiation. Because there's radiation that... There's electromagnetic radiation, magnetic waves, electricity, light. Those are all types of radiation.
Yeah, X-rays,
ultraviolet
waves, FM radio waves.
X-rays are the only ones that are technically ionizing radiation.
Right.
So we study half-life as well, how long something stays radioactive.
Mm-hmm.
It does different. It does differ between different elements.
Yeah, half-life is an interesting concept. So if we think about it this way, if I'm going to move from here to the wall, halfway to the wall. Every time I move, I'm going to go halfway. Will I ever touch the wall?
Nope.
So if something is radioactive and decays to a half-life, will it ever actually ever be gone?
Nope.
No. It will just get into a minuscule.
Such an almost undetectable amount.
Right.
Transmutations are a major part of nuclear chemistry. It's whenever an unstable nucleus that is got too many neutrons in it, goes through a decay, and that's called a transmutation. It's like it changes from one element to the other sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
It splits apart sometimes, or sometimes it goes bloop and just magically changes into the next heaviest element or something like that.
But this big bad word, transmutation, is really a generic word for whenever I'm changing the nucleus, artificially or naturally.
Correct.
So when you see transmutation, that trans is the change word.
Mm-hmm.
Our nucleus is changing in somehow.
Yep.
But this is an overarching umbrella term, right? Now we get into specifics. So fission is when I break it and I break it apart with something. So this is going to be a transmutation specifically that's artificial.
Yes.
Because I'm going to hit it with an alpha particle, or I'm going to hit it with a beta particle, or I'm going to hit it with a neutron and break the nucleus apart.
Yep.
And so my parent nuclei is going to get split, and I'm going to have two daughter nuclei that are smaller.
Another really, really, really important thing about fission is that energy is produced.
True.
Okay.
And, you know, this is the only thing we can do on the planet, right?
We can't do fusion. We have done fusion for like billionths of a second, but it's not sustainable. It doesn't
continue. Fusion is what's happening in the sun.
Yes. So I wouldn't call fusion artificial because it's happening naturally in our solar system under the immense gravity and crushing pressure inside of our own sun. But it's a transmutation that, in general, two light parent nuclei, like two hydrogen atoms,
slam together and
are
make a helium.
Combined into a heavier helium nucleus, and again, a ton of energy is produced.
Oh, a ton.
I mean, think about how
outside on a sunny
is.
Day, think about how far away that sun is, and you can feel it on your skin.
And
you can just feel the energy.
Not only that, but only one fraction of all the energy that's coming out of the sun actually hits Earth.
Right, because it's going in all directions.
It's a sphere.
Right.
So, yeah, I mean, wow. Tons of energy, right?
Tons.
Also in the sun, tons of fusions going on. It's not like
tons.
One. Not like,
yeah. Hey, smart guy came up with an equation.
What was it?
E equals mc squared. And another smart guy wants to tell you a little bit more about that equation.
Well, this is the mass energy equivalence in the universe. Chemistry, we only study mass and energy. Well, Einstein back in 1905 theorized and then was proven true that you can convert mass into energy. And that basically what the equation means is because the speed of light is so huge, that a tiny little bit of mass on the order of like a few fractions of a gram
completely turned into energy would be a good amount of energy.
Huge. So whenever a transmutation occurs, fission or fusion or natural, a very small amount of mass, a few protons or something to that effect, actually gets converted into pure energy. This is called the mass defect. It's yes. like the missing mass that got turned into pure energy. And we humans actually use that for two major uses.
Yeah, for energy anyways. And we won't be tracking that, though. When we balance our equations, that mass defect won't come into
because
play.
It's so tiny, we don't even miss it.
Right. So here we go. Nuclear weapons and nuclear power. This is where the mass defect comes into play, that we manipulate. This missing transmutation is converted into this energy. We harvest this energy, critical mass, fissile material. That is like
a few kilograms.
Now we're talking boom.
Right.
Or we're talking those rods that are going to heat up the water. And then we're going to use that water to turn turbines. So we're going to, right now we can create nuclear energy into electricity.
Yes.
Because we actually, what we're actually doing is heating the water really fast, really hard.
And you have to have a critical mass because, as we said, the mass defect is so tiny in a single transmutation that you have to have a lot of material to actually have it add up and really be measurable.
Right.
So the amount of heat released in the nuclear weapon relies upon a large amount of material being converted at once.
Right.
And the same, like he said, for the rods in the nuclear reactors. They only get hot because they're so concentrated and there's a lot of transmutations occurring at once.
Right next to each other. So nuclear power generation?
Fission reactions, so non-fusion, fission, big heavy nuclei, produce a large amount of heat when they go through their transmutations. And that heat is used to boil water. And when water boils, it goes from 1 mole of water, 18 grams, I could hold it in my hand, to 22 liters, and produces a lot of pressure. That change in volume can spin a fan called a steam turbine that spins, moves a dynamo, and creates electricity. Yep. So nuclear power is really only used radioactive material because it can produce heat.
Really? That's really what it comes down to.
And the heat boils water. So does a coal power plant. So does a natural gas power plant. Yep. But the pros of nuclear power are...
Well, ready? So here's... right. Nuclear power, I think this is some of the stuff we actually come in having a lot of background knowledge. So I'm not going to produce a lot of the...
CO2.
Yeah, the greenhouse gases.
Right.
So no emissions, if you will. It's very efficient use of energy, period. And then the fuel source lasts quite a long time. Once I have the rod is active for a long time, right? And then because of that, it's what we call cheap.
Relatively. I mean, it costs billions of dollars to build a nuclear power plant, but... it'll stay in service for a very long time and produce a ton of electricity for a small amount of nuclear fuel.
Relative. Right. So this stuff is all relative. Okay. And then we have the actual reactor going on and we can talk about some of the cons.
Yes. Well, waste. Those fuel rods don't last forever and you got to do something with them once they're done.
And they are radioactive and they tend to, in that case, be almost poisonous to many things.
Definitely.
That's not a good radioactive.
No, it's not a good.
Not a good.
This is toxic for long periods of time. I mean, if your reactor's using uranium, it's 4.5 billion years for one half-life to occur. And we're mentioning we've got hundreds of kilograms of this stuff. So in 4.5 billion years, which is, by the way, as old as our planet is, only half of 100 kilograms of material would have gone away.
That's why it's going to stay around for a long time. But when it's when it stops having its bang for its buck, we say it's spent. It's not producing
as
the
much
energy
efficiency
as we want it to. So now we have to do something.
And we don't really recycle it like we should. But there's also these chances of meltdowns. Chernobyl, Fukushima. Three Mile Island. Or other release events where this stuff got out, away.
A lot of times it's transporting the waste
from
one site to another, and states are like, whoa, I'm not even using this stuff. I'm not producing this, but you're going to transport the stuff over my state to this other state, and you're
crazy.
And you just spilled it all
in
my state. Now I'm mad.
I think we've got a couple more to do.
Let's get going.
Nuclear medicine is really simple. Some radioactive isotopes are used to treat and diagnose cancer.
So thyroid is iodine. You need to know that.
Got to know it. Cobalt-60 is radiation therapy. Okay. Uranium, fuel.
Yep.
And carbon-14 for carbon dating.
How old are the bones?
Yep.
Natural sources, food and carbon-14. Earth gives us uranium and the sun gives us our cosmic radiation. And we did that slide really fast because guess what?
That's it. We're all done. Okay. See you in class. Push it a button and make stop.
Yes.
Push it a button.